Today we have with us Grandmaster Abhijit Kunte, who's been into chess since very long and has achieved numerous titles and has been doing wonderful in the field of chess. So let's start a conversation with him and let's get to know what he has to share with us of his chess career. First of all, a very warm welcome, sir. And thanks a lot for scheduling this interview with us. And we are really grateful that you have provided us with some time so that we can have a conversation with you.
Thank you, Sri.
So, first of all, a very heartiest congratulations on receiving the award for service in sports from Rotary Club of Katraj, Pune. It's really nice to see that you've been still really active with the things that are going on. And Team Nurtr would like to congratulate you for the same, sir.
Thank you very much.
So this Holi seemed to be really colorful, sir. You had a wonderful time with Padmini, Isha at PSPB Bangalore. So how was the experience, sir?
Well, I think the Bangalore organizers, which was organized by MRP at Bangalore Refinery. Mm-hmm. So they made sure that all the players celebrate Holi. Mm-hmm. And the start of the game, like all the organizers with their volunteers were there with the colors. Mm-hmm. And since it was a individual tournament, mm-hmm. so everybody had a free mind also to play with the colors.
Right.
And it was really nice because very rarely we get all the chess players together for a Holi celebrations because it's very rare that all the top players are there and there is also celebration happening. Mm-hmm. So it was a good opportunity for all of us to enjoy it. Mm-hmm.
So, sir, there's an interesting story behind your chess career, a story that says you started playing chess because of your sister, Mrunalini Kunte. Could you please elaborate on the story for our audience?
You know, like all the children, I used to play cricket.
Okay.
And, that was my passion. Mm-hmm. So, one day my coach, Mr. Mohan Patke, so he visited one inter-school tournament where Mrunal was playing there. Mm-hmm. And that time very few women chess players were there. So okay. He came to my house and requested the parents that they should send Mrunal to a chess class. And it was way back in 1984, 85.
Okay.
So that time chess class itself was, something very, very different. Mm-hmm. So my parents said, no, we cannot do it and it's too expensive. Mm-hmm. But then Mr. Padke insisted that he was very confident that he can make a woman chess player into a national level chess player very soon. Mm-hmm. He said, no, you send it her to my class and I will make her a national player in 2 years.
Okay.
So that time, I think the fees were 10 rupees. So he said that, no, we will give you a discount of 50%, but you must send her. Mm-hmm. So that's how she started going to a chess class. It was just 5 minutes walkable distance from my house. So that was an additional advantage. And first day she went there, but she lost, I think. And so she came back and she said, my mom, that she's not going from tomorrow. Mm-hmm. So my mom said, no, but you have to go. But then she said, then okay, send Abhijit also to the class.
Okay.
And I was playing a match. Mm-hmm. But my mom said, no, you also have to accompany her for a chess class. So my first day I went crying to the chess class. But it was warmth of Mr. Mohan Padke and his wife. So we call her Taku. So mm-hmm. she made sure that I am comfortable.
I am not crying. And that's how it started.
So, sir, who had been your chess coaches in your formative years?
So my first coach was Mr. Mohan Padke.
Okay.
Basically he made sure that, that time there were not many books available or not many players to play because that was one of the challenges that since we were very young, mm-hmm. no one will play with us mm-hmm. because they were we cannot lose to.
Mm-hmm.
And so we made sure that we practice among ourselves and grow. Mm-hmm. And he also gave that confidence that even if you don't have books, mm-hmm. you play in such a way that people will write books on you.
Right.
That kind of encouragement and confidence, so what we don't have, we should not count. What we have, that's what we should think and we should progress. So that was a motto of Mr. Padke. And he was a state level player, but with a lot of values, and he made sure that we become tough to survive this world without much of a chess, formal chess knowledge, but practical play.
Okay.
We used to practice every day, and like his house was only 5 minutes from my home. So I used to go every day morning to his home, and that time it was not like right now, it is not your time for the coaching. So like we used to go to his house anytime when I want, and I used to play 2-3 games with him. Then he has to go to bank to work. So his wife will say, okay, now stop. He has to go for
okay.
How the schedule was, but it was never, I think it was more than chess and coach. I think it was more than that. And so he was my first coach, and then Mr. Arun Vaidya, he shifted to Pune. He was an international master and national player.
Mm-hmm.
So I worked with him for almost 4 years,
mm-hmm.
where I learned how to prepare openings in proper way, kind of things. Then in 1996, in national championship, I had a big setback where I finished last.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
So that, you know, I worked with my sister extensively, and I also started self-learning a lot.
Mm-hmm.
I think that defeat I always consider as one of the coach, because
okay.
That defeat taught a lot of things.
Mm-hmm.
And then I had trainings, but it was a short training. But I had trained with Mr. Grandmaster Ubi Lava and Vladimiro.
Mm-hmm.
So I had a lot of sessions with them from 98 to 2000, like 2012, you can say.
Okay. So,
but
so
it was not a regular training.
Okay. Okay. So as you mentioned about self-learning, sir, so do you find like self-learning is the best way to learn certain things, or do you always need some guidance in the form of a coach? Like what can make you learn better on your own, analyzing your own games, your own failures, or is that you always need a coach for learning things?
I think you need a coach, because coach, you have a coach, your learnings will be faster.
Mm-hmm.
Is important because you cannot have coach all the time with you.
Right.
So it cannot happen that without a coach you just cannot progress.
Mm-hmm.
So self-learning is important part, but I think coach makes things much more easier.
Okay. So sir, now that you coach youngsters, what are those few things that you have taken as an inspiration from your own coaches that you try to impart to your children also? While coaching them. That's the best inspiration.
So basically, they
apart
have to
from
make,
that, sir.
Okay, of course, there are some tricks and basic ideas about chess, but I think more than that, it's about how to prepare chess. How you should work on your chess. So basically methodology, that's what they need to learn, because most of the players are very good.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe they are going wrong here and there, and the basic, if you just, with the experience, you know like what has to be done. So if you just guide them properly, they are able to take it on.
So
actually, regularly, I don't find so much time, you know, like coaching is a full-time job.
Right.
So still I'm playing for almost 4 to 5 months in a year.
Okay.
So it's not possible for me to do a full-time coaching at session.
Okay.
So it's more of a guidance or mentoring than a regular coaching, that's what I say.
Okay, sir. So who have been the major contributors for your successful chess career? Though I know one of them, your sister, but besides that, whom do you consider as one of the significant people who have played a good role in you being a grandmaster today?
I think my family is the most important part, because like we were from middle class family.
Mm-hmm.
And at that time playing chess itself was a big challenge.
Okay.
Because when I started playing, it was only as a hobby, because I was never a professional player.
Right.
My sister was.
Mm-hmm.
But I became national champion, and then I just continued with it.
Okay.
So my parents have sacrificed a lot, and without their support, I don't think it was possible for both of us to reach at this level.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, there are friends, like we used to miss so much school and college exams. So they used to make sure that we get enough marks and enough notes to prepare for the exams.
Right.
Then my coaches, then my fellow players, like who used to come for practice. Mm-hmm. Because that time, since books were not available, playing with someone, that was only practice. There were people who used to come and practice with us. So, you know, I don't think a player can, you can make a player just by oneself. So there has to be a group of people who are supporting and helping him out.
So, sir,
I will say as a very conducive atmosphere for becoming a chess player, because people are very friendly, supportive. Mm-hmm. The traveling time is less, so it's easy to mingle with more chess players.
Okay.
And Pune, of course, it's a place of education, so a lot of brilliant people are here. So it makes much more easy.
Sir, if you look back towards your journey, do you think if there were certain things you could have done the other way, you could have become a grandmaster much earlier, or this journey would have been a lot different if you could have done certain things differently?
I think I should have moved to Europe much earlier.
Okay.
Which I never did. But I think now, that time there were no resources available.
Right.
But
right.
If I would have moved to Europe, maybe the things would have been completely different. That's what I feel. Because there were not many events possible in India. That time communication was also not so easy.
Mm-hmm.
So like to get a tournament, we had to wait for fax, then get an invitation, then do a visa. A lot of formality, you know, like to go abroad was not that easy.
Right.
But so that time moving to Europe was a big advantage, I feel, because you could have get invitations and more number of events much easier as compared to now.
Okay.
And the most of the, even the coaching facilities or the training partners were easily available in Europe than compared to India. So I should have gone to a place where, you know, chess has that good atmosphere where you can grow. Because after, I think, 2005-06, because of internet, things changed drastically.
Right.
I think from 2005 to 2002, that was a time when I think I could have moved out of India.
Okay. So, sir, as you said, like a chess never had a good culture back then, when you were in your formative years. So, how hard was it for you financially, you know, to take part in events or to go for the different tournaments or even to get chess training? So I definitely might think so, like it might have been tough back then. So what's your take on that?
So like when I used to travel to Sangli, that was the only tournament which was available in India, betting tournament. So we used to play in Sangli for almost 15 days, 20 days in the month of May.
Okay.
So we used to sleep in dormitory with parents, and like we always used to have one thali among myself, my sister and my mother. So that's how the situation was back then, because there was not enough money to, you know, spend. But I think things improved once I got the scholarship with Union Bank, then I got a scholarship with Indian Oil, and then I got a job with Indian Oil.
Right.
So things started changing in 94 onwards. Then my sister also got a job with IDBI Bank. So after that, the things changed drastically because of the institutional support. But I think till that time, it was real tough.
Okay. But still, you managed to go through all the hardships, and you come what may, you definitely thought of pursuing chess no matter what. How hard was it? You never gave up on that.
Well, I think giving up is one thing I don't do so easily. So
okay. So you've been into chess for more than 3 decades now, and what all are the positive and negative changes that you've seen throughout the years? Like, you might have observed a quite large number of variations that have taken place in the sport itself. So what all are the positive and negative things that you find right now?
So when
that time, it was like India was not among the top 20 countries in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Today we are in top 5. Number 2 is the players back then, we had no opportunities, and
players are invited all over the world.
The back then India was not among the top 20 countries in the world, mm-hmm. but now the things have changed and we are among the top.
And the growth in India is really, really strong.
Mm-hmm.
The prize money is decent now. I think yes. many of the top chess players have got the jobs. But you know, like when I became a fourth Grandmaster of India,
mm-hmm.
and that time it was a very big opportunity and big achievement.
Mm-hmm.
Like I was a national champion already.
Mm-hmm.
Now we have 61 Grandmasters.
Right.
So I think the law of marginality is taking place, and it is not easy for a grandmaster to survive just by playing chess.
Okay.
So I think now the biggest challenge is how the players will survive as a professionals. I think that is one of the biggest challenges right now the chess has. And we are not competing anymore with European countries, but I think we are competing with the different sports in India. And the opportunities in different sports right now, what I see, are much higher mm-hmm. as compared to chess, financially I'm talking. So it might happen that, you know, not people taking up chess might become less mm-hmm. after the age of 15 or 16.
Mm-hmm. So sir, this this competition with other sports that you're talking about right now, do you find it as a negative that is being there in the domain of chess now?
I feel so.
Okay. Yeah, because people nowadays enjoy more fame, like the sport that gives them more fame or kind of stuff like that. They tend to pursue those games. But I feel like chess also has its fame in its own to great extent. So what's your take on that, sir?
No, chess has a fame. I'm not denying that. I'm saying that
chess players are declining.
Okay.
So like when I became a grandmaster, I already had a job. You can see now 61 grandmasters, many of them still don't have good jobs.
Right. So is it necessary like to pursue a certain alternate career also despite being a grandmaster?
Most of the grandmasters, either they're working or they're training.
Right.
So just by playing chess, I don't see many chess players are able to. So what I feel as a chess to survive as a professional sport,
okay.
The top 100 chess players should be able to survive as a professional.
Okay.
Unless that happens, we can't say chess as a professional sport.
Okay. Okay. So, sir, back then we were talking about the national premier title that took place in 1996. And you finished last in that title. But exactly after 1 year, you reversed the results. I don't know how. And you finished that tournament on position one. So what exactly was the action plan for 1 year, sir? And what all did you do that went right for that 1 year?
You know, like till that time, I was a junior that time.
Okay.
Yeah, so I won the national juniors in 95.
Okay.
And I was on 17. So I won the junior in 95, won the national junior in 96. And that time there were not many events to play. So we used to play in national sub junior, then Asians, world, and then one or two rating tournaments, and then this national day. So I started my first national senior championship in 96.
Okay.
So that was the first time I played in the national B championship. So that time it was national B and national A. Then you had to qualify for national A. So that qualification itself was a big achievement that time.
Mm-hmm.
I was the youngest participant, I think, in that tournament. And so, you know, the format of playing round robin, like it was my first round robin tournament. I had never played in the round robin. So the strategy is different in playing in round robin. Like it's a long tournament, you have to play 15 games.
Mm-hmm.
I have always played junior events where it is very important to score high.
Mm-hmm.
It's a 9-round tournament and you have to score maximum points.
Right.
So scoring high is very important because you don't get a lot of opponents.
Right.
But in national, all the players are qualified, so you know, all have a very good standing and strength.
Mm-hmm.
So,
but it was more important that you should be able to play for the 15 rounds with same amount of energy.
Right. Right.
So the strategies were different, but I was unaware of it.
Mm-hmm.
I just went for the kill from day one. Okay. And I think it just backfired. Like I,
okay.
Then I thought, okay, how it is going? I had to win more games. Mm-hmm. But it just didn't work out. So when next year I just analyzed it, I just realized that, you know, I have a very bad opening preparation
mm-hmm.
to play in the National Senior Championships.
Okay.
So I need to work on that. So I just really worked hard on the opening.
Mm-hmm.
And it was very important that I did not fight all the games till the end. I can just play a theoretical game, and if it is not working, I can just equalize and get out.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, especially against strong players. So I didn't change the strategy for that year, and the next year it just worked out.
Okay.
But you know, that 1 year of preparation helped me, because I still remember that was my final year BCom, 97.
Okay.
And I had my exams in May, and at the national level, I was just finishing 1 week before that.
Okay.
So I was also preparing for exams when I was playing the national level. And
right.
I won my national near third time in a row in that year.
Okay.
That was a national record. Then I won this national A,
mm-hmm.
and I became international master. Then in December, I also won the Asian Junior Championship.
Okay.
So, you know, this, for hard work just pays off.
Right, right. Hard work definitely pays off one day or the other. So you told me about you were really bad at opening game during the time you lost. So you worked on that part. So could you please tell our audience what all steps did you follow for improving your opening game? Like, did you read any books, or you went to a different coach, or what was that exactly you did to improve with the opening part?
That time it was different part. We had to use Informator and different magazines and take a Xerox, make a file. It's
yeah.
like old way of preparing, which
yeah.
now nobody believes in because of the computers.
Yeah.
You know, I had to make all these files and go through all the positions
mm-hmm.
and play the games at particular positions. That was the main 3 steps I took.
Okay. And I also got to know when you were playing certain tournaments, you had your exams, as you told. So how hard was it for you to manage both the things, your academics and your game? Because children these days face this concern a lot. Like, they leave playing chess just because they have certain exams. I am in conversation with certain chess players, certain kids who are at the age of 10 to 11. And they say we cannot play chess in the month of March or April just because we have our exams coming up. So they involve that 2 month gap period in their game. That definitely affects their game one way or the other. So if you could tell them how to manage academics and the game, so then there would be no gaps in their chess playing career.
No, I always feel that education and chess always go hand in hand, and they are complementary to each other.
Okay.
Because they are different.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you are playing chess,
mm-hmm.
Once you get tired, you can just start studying. So it's change of work. So it's like a relaxation.
Okay.
So it helps a lot. That's what I feel. Because I remember that I got all my important titles when I was having an important exam. Like, I won my national sub-juniors when I was in 10th. And I remember that I had an exam after 1 week after I came back.
Mm-hmm.
I won, I think, national juniors first time when I was in 12th.
Mm-hmm.
I won the national premier championship when I was doing BCom final year.
Okay.
And I became a Grandmaster in February. And after 2 months, I had my final year exam for the Masters in Finance.
Okay.
So I did my Diploma in Business Management and Masters in Finance after graduation.
Okay. Okay. So, sir, how did you manage all the pressure that was there on your head, like your exams also, your games also, tournaments, and then you turning out and winning all those tournaments? I hope pressure worked in your favor.
Okay, exams I think was the easiest part because I had a lot of friends. So I, before the exam, I will get ready notes. So I just need to read it and write it.
Okay.
So that was easiest. Chess was always tough because it's not predictable.
Right. But you managed them really well, and that definitely proves that this day really
I
proves
that.
I was
surprised because I got a distinction in all my exams.
Okay.
So, from Diploma and Finance Masters. So
okay.
I passed with a distinction. So I was also surprised when I saw the results.
That's really nice to hear that, sir. So were there any high points and low points in your chess career? Like, everyone has a good day, a good game, or a bad game. Then you might have also experienced certain such days in your life, you know, which were not that colorful. So could you please share a few of them with us?
I think in sports, there are more bad days than colorful days.
Okay.
Because you don't win every day. Like, you know, like you can win a game, but you don't win a tournament, or you miss something. Maybe you just draw a winning game.
Mm-hmm.
So, we always had more tough time than successful days.
Mm-hmm.
But I think eventually you understand that it's part of life and you just can't be afraid of losing.
Mm-hmm.
So, you have to take even the losing positively, understand your mistakes and take it forward. It's very easy to say it, but it's very difficult to go through it.
Implement it.
Every loss is a pain.
Yeah.
So I think that's part of the sport, that you have to, you know, take that pain and move forward.
So it's not easy, but do you remember certain games or certain tournaments, like on the days when you felt really painful, losing was really a big thing back then?
I remember when I was playing national under 12 in 1989.
Mm-hmm.
I had to win that game to become a national champion, and I blundered my three. I was 3 points up against RK Kamath of Bihar, and then he became a national champion. I finished second.
Okay.
That was the first day I remember where I missed a golden opportunity of becoming a national champion. And right. Then there are n number of days, you know, when I have missed it.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it's part of life. You have to just move on. I think the biggest, worst part of my time was 99, because I made my second GM norm in 1998.
Mm-hmm.
And the 1998 March to 1999 December, mm-hmm. I missed my GM norm 4 times by half point.
Okay.
And that was really hard, because it was very close, but I was not able to get it, and it started creating a lot of frustration.
Right.
That, okay, this is going to happen or not. And that time, the Grandmaster title was something really, really big.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember I was playing in London, and I had a last game with Leo Sarkis.
Mm-hmm.
And I had to win that game for a norm.
Mm-hmm.
If I draw, I was finishing third. And he was already the champion. So he offered me a draw. And I told him, no, I have to play the game.
Mm-hmm.
And then we played, and finally I lost the game. So he said, like, why you are playing so desperately? So I said, no, because I was getting a Grandmaster. So he told me, it's so easy to get a Grandmaster. Why are you worried? I said, oh, just put all your pieces in the center and you make a Grandmaster. No. That's what was his advice. And then next tournament in Calcutta, I made my final. So I learned to, I accepted his advice, I think. And just,
yeah.
It's all in.
Okay.
So before that, I just, period was very bad.
Okay.
Bad in the sense, I was not performing badly, but I was just not achieving what I wanted.
Right. So, sir, during this phase of your life, when you were working really hard, you were putting all the efforts you could, but still you were not able to achieve that Grandmaster title. As you mentioned, like, you were losing it by half a point or so. So what was that one thing that kept you going? Like, no matter how many losses I fail, I'll still be in the race to become a Grandmaster. There might be some source of inspiration or motivation behind you. So what was that?
I think this attitude builds into you.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if you see that we never had the resources, all the resources to fight for. So
okay.
It was always lack of resources. So you always become very strong without the resources mentally, mm-hmm. because you know that you have to do it by hook or crook. That becomes your attitude. And that's what my coach and my parents have taught me, never give up.
Okay.
So I always say, you know, like, I like this line of Winston Churchill where he said, what is success?
Mm-hmm.
So he defined success in a very interesting way. He said, it's man's ability to move from one defeat to another, mm-hmm. with equal amount of enthusiasm.
Right. That's really inspiring, sir. That's really inspiring. So, which one is your favorite game? Like, you've played so n number of games till now. Which one would you regard as your favorite game, and what is the probable reason behind that?
I think I can say one. There are many, but one I still remember. I think the most important was the British Championship, where I had to beat this Peter Wells.
Okay.
In the penalty mid round, that was a very crucial game, and it was I played it in a very technical fashion.
Okay.
So I liked that game very much. Okay. But of course, there are many others.
Okay. So, sir, are you a positional player or a tactical player? Like, what is your playing style?
I don't know. I'm not going to give my secrets.
We would try our best to know that, sir.
My opponent is judging.
Okay. You've wore so many hats in the field of chess. You've been a player, an administrator, a coach, and so on. So, which role do you enjoy the most, sir? And what point of time was that you felt like switching from one role to the other?
I think organizer means, okay, I was involved only in organizing this chess league.
Mm-hmm.
I think so, like, there, since there was no chess league, so we thought that we can do it. And so I spoke with few people and they said yes, it is a very good idea. So I will not say I was the organizer, but okay, I conceptualized a little bit and I talked to few people who could do it.
Okay.
So not exactly like organizer means, you know, he has to do so much work.
Mm-hmm.
You know, to get sent proposals and so on, so on, so on.
Right.
But okay, yes, conceptualization and speaking to people that I could do and I could convince them to start the league. So that was, I think, one of the events which I enjoyed.
Mm-hmm.
And as a coach, I said that, you know, it's on and off. When I'm not playing, some people come and I work with them. But again, it's not a full-fledged thing. So right now, I think still I'm only a chess player.
Okay.
And rest of the things, you know, it's only when I have some extra time.
Okay, so the prime focus will always be playing chess. And on and
yes.
off, if you're not playing chess, then you will be serving the community anyways through by guiding them, by mentoring them maybe, or even by organizing certain tournaments.
Yeah. But okay, even if I get involved in tournament, it has to be something different. Because I don't want to get into regular games.
Okay. Okay. So, so young kids have to absorb a huge amount of pressure these days, you know, due to the competition that's there out today. So what would be your piece of advice for people who get dejected after seeing no growth in their chess and are, you know, complaining always about their poor ratings or maybe stuff like that, and they even contemplate to quit chess? Because I was in conversation with certain players who said that they have been playing chess for past 3 to 4 years, but they still could not see any improvement in the ratings they have. Their ratings are more or less the same. So they feel quite dejected after this. And you know, the only way through which you can categorize your performance, how well you are doing, is the rating. Like, we don't have any other criteria in the field of chess. So if the rating is not improving, so what could be the piece of advice for you, on your side, for such audience?
So basically, I always say that if something is not working,
mm-hmm.
and if you keep on doing it in the same fashion, it is still not going to work.
Mm-hmm.
There has to be some change.
Right.
So where you have to put that change, that I think situation will demand. Like, either you need to change your playing pattern, you need to change your training pattern, you need to play openings, you need to change the coach, you need to play different tournaments, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
But there has to be some change because something is not working, right?
Mm-hmm.
So in that case, the change has to happen.
Okay.
But if you just keep on doing same way, in same fashion, it is going to give you same result.
Right. And that won't be an intelligent move. Like, if you are trying the similar things and you're expecting different results, that would more or less not work out. Okay.
It will not work.
Yeah. So, sir, today's kids are acquiring GM titles at a very, very young age. Like you might have heard about Grandmaster Enian, the 61st Grandmaster India has produced. So the race to be the youngest GM is so in that it is creating a healthy competition, more or less, in the chess environment. But do you think, like, is it appreciable, or this healthy competition should exist, or is it just pressurizing students? Is it an undue pressure, like you have to be a grandmaster by certain age or else you won't get that fame or you won't be that appreciated if you become a grandmaster at certain older age? So what's your take on that?
See, finally what I will say is grandmaster is important, but it's just a starting thing for the international community. So there has that importance. Okay, it has just evaded now, because now it is not important when you become a grandmaster. Now it is important what age you are becoming a grandmaster.
Right.
So somebody can say 20, it is no more important. It's not a news even for many people.
Right.
So I think the title has lost that charm. That's what I will say.
Mm-hmm.
Because there are so many now. Mm-hmm. But becoming at young age gives that thing that, you know, what people are achieving at 20, you are achieving it at 12. That means you are definitely good.
Mm-hmm.
So I think achieving it at young age is a competition.
Mm-hmm.
And people who are achieving have a good chance to move forward at, in the world ranking.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So because more or less,
thing, you know, it's easy to get the invitations. Because it is not easy to get invited for the good important events.
Mm-hmm.
So easy for Indians.
Okay.
You know, this fame gives you a chance to get invited for good events.
Okay. So will that hold a larger difference in the chess career? Like if you become a grandmaster at the age of 11 and you becoming a grandmaster at the age of 22 maybe. So do you think it will impact the overall chess career of a person?
Yes.
Okay. So you would prefer being a grandmaster at the age of 11 in comparison to the other case?
Unfortunately, I became 24.
But still, you're doing quite great, sir.
That time it was the youngest.
Yeah, definitely, definitely. So, sir, are your kids also passionate about chess, and do they learn chess from you?
Yeah, both of them know chess. So my younger one is still learning. The elder, my daughter, has stopped playing chess. She's into arts.
Okay.
She's in the 7th.
Okay. So do you encourage them to play chess maybe as a hobby, or not as a serious thing, but do you encourage them to play chess as a sport? Or you have left it up to them, whatever they want to do?
My son loves cricket, so I don't know whether I should remove him from cricket or not. So he's still playing cricket and chess more.
Okay.
So let's see.
Okay. Sir, what all qualities do you think that a parent should look for in a chess coach before sending their kids to that respective academy or platform? What all qualities should we look for in a coach?
I think coach has to be a model for a chess player. Because, mm-hmm. you know, like you always get that value system from a coach. Because when you're young, whatever your coach says is very, very important.
Right.
Even more than the parents. So I think the coach should have that value system with him. Second thing is he should have a passion to teach. And third thing, he should have the children's interest as a foremost thing.
Okay. So this comes, lets me to the other question, that do you prefer like a chess should be taught as an offline thing, or even online coaching can help a child equally?
I think offline, online is, I think it's not important anymore, right?
Because,
okay, when you are very young, it's very tough for online coaching maybe. But mm-hmm. once you know how to move and all, I think it's easy.
Because certain parents have this concern, like things will be taught online and the mentor won't be present there physically with their child. So how will he be able to learn better? Because in chess, you need the physical presence of the tutor to be there. So is that the case? Do you feel the same?
I don't think so. Okay, it depends on what standard you are, what level you are.
Okay.
Like the basic, I think it's tough. because the child will not understand it. Mm-hmm. And what is the age? That is also matters.
Okay. But
I think we should use the technology to the maximum. Yeah, otherwise, what's the use of technology?
Right. What's that one skill that you think after playing chess has made chess players exceptionally good outside the chess world? Like one thing that you learned through chess, and you are implying that in your real life also, and that thing is really helping you in your personal and professional life also, that you have learned through chess.
I will say planning.
Okay. Okay, planning is that certain one thing. Okay. So, sir, where do you see the future of chess in India as of now?
Of course, I think we will become top three countries in the world. I think Russia, China, and India.
Okay.
So, the question is when.
Okay.
And the way we are growing,
mm-hmm.
I think we should have few players in top 5 or top 10 in the world very soon.
Mm-hmm.
The question will be like when we can get a series of world champions.
Okay.
Because that is a main question, because mm-hmm. we don't have any player in top 10 in the world
mm-hmm.
for almost so many years. And still only Vishwanathan Anand is there. Other
right.
than that, we don't have any player who has become world champion or close to it.
Right.
So when we will get that is a question.
Okay.
Because finally, you know, it is the world champions who can create that interest among the sports in that country.
Right,
like if you
right.
take Saina Nehwal, she created Indian badminton, and this
right.
Sania Mirza in tennis, and now Deepa Karmakar in gymnastics.
Mm-hmm.
So we need some torchbearers, some idols who create that momentum in the sport.
Mm-hmm.
Vishwanathan Anand, like luckily, became a world grandmaster. And then like he became world number 3 in the 91-92, and then the chess started growing.
Right.
So luckily I was there that time, you know, all of us. Because of
right.
his performances, the chess was getting more, encouragement, and even people were recognizing chess players as the sports persons.
Okay.
So that helped all of us.
Okay.
So I think we need one more player to become a world champion. So that will take us to the next level.
Right, right. So, sir, what do you think? Like, chess is more of an individual sport, or when it comes representing India, or when it comes to a team? Because recently, World Team Chess Championship happened, and India was in a race towards a medal, but somehow in the last rounds, things got a little tough for us, and we still missed out on the team medal. But individually, Grandmaster Adiban won gold. So do you think like chess is more of an individual sport, or it should be team oriented, or what is your take on this?
Adiban and Ganguly both won the gold medal.
Yeah, right.
And see, if you are playing good at your board, team is going to perform well. So
mm-hmm.
like even if it is a team sport, like team events, your individual board matters a lot.
Okay.
So, you know, team event, it matters, you know, who is going to take white and black. So, in that, if you have a sportsmanship and you consider everybody should get equal, then that team spirit is better.
Okay.
But I think individual performance will only help the team.
Okay. 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 So, this brings us to the end of interview, sir. It was really nice talking to you, and you definitely added a great amount of humor to this interview. Thanks a lot for scheduling some time for us, and it was lovely speaking to you, sir.